And today I'm going to talk about T2P channels, about heteromerization, about translation, and I will talk about migraine also. Migraine is a common neurological disorder which affects around 20% of the adult population in the world, and the prevalence is 3 times more important for the women. The mechanism underlying the migraine are not very well understood, but something that is well admitted in the field is that the hyperexcitability of the trigeminal neurons can trigger migraine. And the excitability of neurons is under the control of a current which has been described during the 50s by Hutchkin and Huxley, which is called the leak or background potassium current. This current in 1996 have been shown by Lazansky and Lesage to be carried by the K2P channels. Why K2P channels? Because you have two P loops per subunit which are composing these channels. And as you need four P loops to have a functional channel, these channels are active as a dimer. At rest, these channels are open and allow the selective transport of potassium ion through the plasma membrane from inside to outside the cell, inducing an hyperpolarization of the cell and the silencing of the neuron. But when you close this channel, you will have a depolarization and the neuron will start to fire again, meaning the fundamental function of this channel is to remote control the excitability. 15 genes have been found to encode for this potassium channel family, and 6 of them have been found to be highly expressed in trigeminal neurons. The TRK channel members, TRK1, TRK2, and TRK, also the TASC channel member, TASC1 and TASC3, and TRESC. And the importance of this channel in the migraine induction has been shown in 2010 in a paper in Nature Medicine, where the authors have shown that a mutation, which is called the TRESC-MT mutation, leads to migraine. This mutation is a two-pair-based deletion which induces the formation of a truncated channel, which is composed of only one transmembrane segment and a little bit of the second one. This channel is not functional, and in addition to be not functional, act as a dominant negative form on the wild-type subunit. Meaning, if you overexpress this channel with a wild-type, you have a strong decrease of the wild-type current. When you overexpress this channel in the trigeminal neurons, you have an increase of the excitability of this neuron that explains its function in the induction of the migraine. But this discovery later on has been questioned. In fact, it has been discovered another mutant, the C110R, in 2012. And this mutation, as the mutation MT, leads to a channel which is not functional, and in addition to be not functional, is also acting as a dominant negative form on the wild-type subunit. Meaning, again, if you overexpress it with the TRESC subunit, you have a huge decrease of this current. But besides to carry the same function as the TRESC-MT mutant, this mutant, when you overexpress it in trigeminal neurons, does not modify the excitability and is not linked to migraine. Meaning you have two mutations leading to the same function, but one induces a migraine phenotype and the other one not. Recently in a lab, we have shown that the 2P channels are able to heteromerize to increase the functional diversity. Therefore, we have hypothesized that maybe TRESC can heteromerize with other K2PX subunits, and maybe the mutation will affect differently the heteromer involving TRESC and the K2PX subunit. Therefore, we have decided to determine if TRESC is able to heteromerize with other K2PX subunits in trigeminal neurons. To do so, we have developed a technique in the lab which is called a single molecule pull-down assay. This technique consists of the co-expression of the HK2PX subunit that you want to know if this subunit interacts with the TRESC subunit, with the GFP TRESC subunit. Then, you lysate your cell and you flow the lysate directly on the passivated microscope slide, which has been coated with antibodies that will recognize the HK tag and trap this subunit. Then, we reveal the ability of TRESC to interact with K2PX by turf microscopy, like this, and if you see spot, this means that the TRESC has been caught with the K2PX subunit, meaning the TRESC interacts with the K2PX subunit. What is the main advantage of this technique? This technique, first of all, is quantitative, meaning you can count how many spots you have in the field of view, meaning you can have an idea at the single molecular level of how many protein you have in your sample. In addition, you can use also this technique qualitatively, meaning you can determine the stoichiometry of the channel complex by counting the number of bleaching steps. In fact, for example, if you are at a single molecular level and you have like a trimer, and you eliminate your trimer and you are at a single molecular level, you will have in response an emission of fluorescence. If you wait a little bit, at one point, one of the GFP will bleach, meaning one of the GFP will stop to emit photon in a reversible manner. And you will be able to observe a decrease by a step of the intensity of the fluorescence over the time. If you wait a little bit longer, a second GFP will bleach, and you see another step. And then if you wait another time, you will see the third step. And just by counting the number of steps, you can determine the stoichiometry. First, we wanted to validate this approach. To do so, we have overexpressed the HA tag GFP trace cube units that we know it's a dimer. We have Lysette diesel, we throw the Lysette on this passivity microscope slide, and we did a movie. And when you make a movie, oh, it's huge. You can see that each of the spots there correspond to one protein complex, and they start to bleach over the time. And when you make this kind of things, and you look after the number of bleaching steps, you can observe two nice bleaching steps showing that our channel is well a dimer in our system, and the system can be used to determine the subunit assembly of the channel. Therefore, we have overexpressed our K2PX HA subunit with TRESC GFP subunit. Each time you will see spot, this means that you have an interaction. TRESC interacts with itself, meaning it's able to form homomer, but it's also able to heteromerize with TRESC, with TREC1, TREC2, but not with TRAC, not with TASK1, and not with TASK3. Therefore, we know that TRESC in a trigeminal neurons can heteromerize with TREC1 and TREC2. Therefore, we wanted to know now what will be the impact of the mutation on TREC1 and TREC2 current. And to do so, we have overexpressed TREC1 and TREC2 in the absence or in the presence of the TRESC mutant. If you do that, first, if you overexpress the TRESC C110R, which is not involved in the migraine with TRESC, we observe this huge decrease of the current as it was described in the literature. What about TREC1? No effect. Now, if we go for the mutant which is involved in the migraine, we observe also this huge decrease of the current induced with the TRESC current by the TRESC MT mutant. But what about TREC1 and TREC2? Now, you see that TREC1 is totally inhibited by the overexpression of the TRESC MT subunit. Meaning, the difference between the channel, the mutation which is involved in the migraine and the one which is not involved in the migraine resides in its ability to regulate TREC1 and TREC2. Therefore, we have done a little model. This model explains that the TRESC C110R inhibits only TRESC. This is not sufficient to induce an increase of the cell excitability, and therefore you have no migraine. In the case of the TRESC MT mutant, you inhibit TRESC, but by inhibiting TREC1 and TREC2, you may increase the trigeminal excitability that will lead to migraine. Therefore, now we have to show that there is a link between this inhibition and this increase of the cell excitability. And to show the link, we have used a double knockout mice, TREC1, TREC2 knockout mice. And we have looked at the excitability of the neuron from these mice. In the wild-type trigeminal neurons, as I told you before, if you overexpress the TRESC MT mutant, you have a huge increase of the excitability of these neurons, meaning the number of action potential per unit of time is increased. What about the TREC1, TREC2 knockout mice? First, at rest, you can see that the excitability of these neurons is largely above the one you can observe for the wild-type subunit, for the wild-type neuron. What about now the TRESC MT? If you overexpress the TRESC MT in this neuron, you are no longer able to regulate the excitability of this neuron. Therefore, now we have this model to show that the TRESC MT mutant inhibit TREC1 and TREC2, increase the trigeminal neuron excitability that may lead to migraine. Now we have to find the link between the excitability increased and the migraine phenotype. Therefore, we have looked at the behavior of the mice to see if they are or not migrainer. But it's not easy to determine if a mouse presents a migraine phenotype because you cannot talk to the mouse. Therefore, you have to use other tricks to see that. First, you have to induce the migraine. How can you induce the migraine? By giving some NO donors. This is what we have done. And how can you quantify the migraine? You have to know that the migraine is also associated with an hypersensitivity of all the sensory inputs. Therefore, we have looked at the allodynia at the level of the POW. And we measure the POW withdrawal threshold. If you give to a mouse some endodonors and you look at this threshold, you see that you have a decrease of this threshold induced by the endodonors, meaning you have an allodynia that will start to appear. What about the track 1, track 2 knockout mice? As you can see, the threshold is similar to the threshold observed for the wild-type mice in which we have induced the migraine. And now if you give some NO donors to this mouse, as you see, you are no longer able to decrease this PO with the wild threshold. But now if you give a pill that is used in clinic to reverse the migraine phenotype, such as a topiramate, you are able to bring back this mouse to a normal PO with the wild threshold, meaning to a normal sensitivity. This allows us to propose this full model now of the migraine induction. For the TRESC C110R mutant, you just have the inhibition of TRESC, which is not sufficient to induce an increase of the excitability of the cell. There is no migraine phenotype. In the case of the TRESC MT mutant, you have inhibition of TREC1, TREC2, leading to an increase of the trigeminal neuron excitability, leading to the migraine phenotype. Having found all these things, now we wanted to know what are the molecular mechanisms underlying this inhibition of TREC1, TREC2 by the TRESC MT mutant, but not by the C110R mutant. Normally, when you have a dominant negative form of channel, this dominant negative will come on the channel and will interact with it to inhibit the activity of this channel. Therefore, we wanted to know if the TRESC MT mutant was able to interact, to heterize with TREC1, TREC2, and TRESC. And we have used again our technique. TRESC was able to co-IP with MT, meaning we know that TRESC MT interact with TRESC and therefore inhibit the channel. But in the case of TREC1 and TREC2, we were kind of surprised because we didn't observe any spot. Meaning TREC1 and TREC2 are inhibited by this protein without interacting with it. How can you create a channel killer by two-pair-based deletion? To understand that, we made a step backward and we have been back to the cDNA level. What we found that there was an HEG in the sequence of TRESC, which was not in frame in the original sequence of TRESC, but because of the two-pair-based deletion here, this HEG, which is embedded by a COSAC sequence, is now in frame with all this part of the channel. And we have hypothesized that this ATG may serve as an alternative translation initiation site, and that initiation translation and this translation would lead to a production of a second protein, which we call now MT2, which is composed of the second transmembrane segment of TRESC, the third and the fourth transmembrane segment. But first, you have to show that one RNA can encode for two proteins. To address this point, what we have done, we fused in frame with the MT1 open regex frame an MSHERI tag, and we fused with the open regex frame of MT2 the GFP tag. And we have expressed this construct in human cell, dog cell, and primary neuron from mice. As you see, when the cells are red, they are also green, showing that when you express this mutant in the cell, you have expression of MT1 and MT2. If you replace this tag, MSHERI and GFP, by an HA tag, you can see that you have two nice bands that are close to be equal at the intensity level that correspond to the exact weight you expect for MT1 and MT2. Therefore, now we know that one RNA can encode for two proteins. What is the function of these two proteins? To address the function of these two proteins, what we have done, we have introduced a stop codon in the second open regex frame, encoding for the MT2 sequence. And we have overexpressed this mutant with our TREC1 and with our TRESC. If you overexpress it with TREC1, with a stop codon, you lose the regulation of the channel. What about TRESC? As you see, we kept the regulation of TRESC, showing that it looks like that MT1 target TRESC, MT2 should be involved in the regulation of TREC1. We confirm this result by just removing this alternative translation initiation site, by mutating this site. We kept the regulation of TRESC, and we lose again the regulation of TREC1. Therefore, it looks like that MT1 target TRESC, MT2 target TREC1, TREC2. And to confirm this result, we subclone the two RF in two different vectors, and we have expressed these two different constructs with our TREC1 and TRESC. As you can see here, if you overexpress MT1 with TRESC, you have this massive inhibition, as it is expected, no effect on TREC1. For TRESC, no effect of MT2, an effect on TREC1. As I said before, all the migraine induction is linked to the inhibition of TREC1 and TREC2, and now we know that the inhibition of TREC1 and TREC2 is linked to the production of MT2, meaning MT2 should be sufficient to induce an increase of the trigeminal non-excitability that leads to migraine. It's what we have tested with our trigeminal neurons. If you overexpress MT1, which targets only TRESC, you have no effect on the excitability of this neuron. When you overexpress MT2, you have a massive increase of the excitability of this neuron, and this massive increase is totally lost in the TREC1, TREC2 knockout mice, showing that MT2 target well TREC1 and TREC2 to increase the excitability of this neuron. Now the question is, MT2, is it sufficient to induce a migraine phenotype in rodents? To address this point, we have overexpressed in trigeminal neurons using virus the MT2 sequence, only the MT2 sequence, and we have tested the rats, because now it's rats, for their behavior for migraine. And why the rat is a good model? The rat is a good model because we can directly measure not the paw sensitivity, but directly the facial sensitivity, the face. And the face sensitivity is directly linked to the excitability of the trigeminal neurons, meaning we have a direct index of this excitability in the animal. When you do this kind of experiment with the rats, the same as in a mouse, you give some NO donors, and as you can see, we have a decrease of the face withdrawal threshold. What about the rats in which we have overexpressed MT2? Overexpression of MT2 induces a massive decrease of this face withdrawal threshold, meaning you have a massive allodynia, and now you are no longer able to increase the sensitivity when you give some NO donors, showing that MT2 expression is sufficient by itself to induce migraine. Taken together, we have now this model, which explains that the C110R mutant inhibits only TRESC, which is not sufficient to induce an hyperexcitability and therefore no effect, and you can smile. But if you have overexpression of the TRESC, if you express MT mutant, what you will get, you get production of two proteins because of the alternative translation initiation. MT1 that will target TRESC, but there is no effect, and MT2 will target TREC1 and TREC2. And the inhibition of TREC1 and TREC2 will lead to an increase of the excitability of this neuron that will lead to pain. This means that TREC1, TREC2 may be a very good target to cure migraine. It's what we have tested using the SLAV compound that has been developed when SLAV won a postdoc with Dan Minor, the MLS67. What we have done, we have induced in the rats a chronic migraine phenotype. And as you see, when you do that on 4 days, you have a massive decrease of the face withdrawal threshold. Then we have injected to these rats the MLS67. And as you see, you are able to go back to normal. Therefore, this work, I've shown first that TREC1, TREC2 can be used to cure migraine. And also, we have shown that FRAF sheet mutation induced alternative translation initiation is a new mechanism allowing the transmission of inherited diseases. I will finish on a picture of Antibes. Antibes is one of the nicest cities in the world. The lab is localized there. If you want to do a postdoc in a nice place, you are welcome to apply. And I will finish with the people from the lab who work on this project, especially Perrine, because she did her PhD on that, and our colleagues here. And thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Guillaume. I think this sort of exemplifies how we have to be very careful about interpreting the effects of some mutations, and because they can have quite unexpected consequences. So do we have any questions?
Not really, because we just have used the double knockout mice, and it's something that we have to do later. Yeah. But both are very well expressed, because what we have done also, we did some RT-PCR in the single cell, at the single cell level, because the reviewer asked for that. And and we found that the free channels were highly expressed in the small diameter neurons.
Are there any human genetic mutations in TREC1 or TREC2?
Not as I know. But the problem also with migraine, you have to think that when you are a migraineur, you don't go all the time to the hospital. It's not like a disease. You can live with this kind of disease, I think, also, if it's not too severe.
Yeah, for sure. I don't have...
I cannot give like I can have a look later on, but I will not say because I will say something. It's like 50-50. It's like little bit more maybe of MT1, but it's not like the intensity. Because what we have done to measure the intensity and to look at the quantity of proteins was that we put an extract for both forms, meaning we knew that we use the same antibodies to recognize both forms. And the intensity of the band are close to be the same.
David.
The test knockout seems to have like an increase of the excitability of the trigeminal neurons because it was published. But after, I don't know if people have played with another loss with the knockout, test knockout. As far as I know, I don't remember what was in the publication.
Slide.
Yeah, very nice work.
Thank you. The mechanical sensitivity is something that we want to test. We started to talk with Xavier Gassul in Barcelona to test that. We didn't test it yet. But it's something that we have to test because I think it's lost. I'm not sure, but I have to see that. Because you need the 2CT tail of TREC1 to be mechanical sensitive, I think, as far as I remember.
So you showed in the mouse migraine model that they become hypersensitive in the Is it a trigeminal effect or is it the channel also equally
exposed? For the PO is a central effect because what you have here is a sensitization at the central level. That's why after you have a sensitization of all sensory inputs. But the best model was the rats because the rats you measure directly on the face, which is like directly linked to the trigeminal neuron excitability. It's a direct measure. Well, the PO is an indirect index.
So you mean that there is no expression of these channels in the dorsal?
Yeah, you have also expression. Yeah, but this you cannot know because we expect that is a central effect. We expect that the hyperexcitability and the sensitization at the central level that will induce the sensitization at the peripheral level, but we cannot exclude that it's an effect on the GRG. That's why after the rats model confirmed that the effects came from the trigeminal neurons.
Okay, actually, I have a question because a lot of what you've done is with overexpression of these constructs in various cellular systems or in the mice itself. Is there, have you any evidence in, is there a mutant mouse model with this mutation in that you can measure the transcript levels and the protein levels that would be produced in a real situation?
It would be the best model. We don't have it, unfortunately, but...
if the levels of protein that are produced are quite small, then they might get degraded very quickly, which you wouldn't necessarily see in an overexpression system.
But for example, in this case, because overexpression for MT1 is the same, it's also an overexpression, meaning if you have the same quantity of MT1 and MT2 when you overexpress it, you expect to have the same quantity when you don't overexpress it.
Okay, well, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.